a master's in history and school education, certified internal auditor for school management, ISO standards, a qualified parenting coach, and an MBA in HR, has not only enabled her to face life's challenges head-on, but also take along with her, her wards and those associated with her, on the road to success as she takes great pride in shaping their future, not only with knowledge, but also values to make them proud citizens. The great mentors warmly welcome Ms. Abba Jadhav, Principal, Rahul International School, Pune. She is the founder of AJ School of Digital Learning, where she helps people in grooming their personality, digitally, empower aspiring YouTubers with her EY2C program and many more. Her first co-authored book, Rise and Shine, was released last year. Her flagship program on YouTube, Spotlight with Abba, helped her be declared as one of India's top 10 YouTubers in 2020. Her motto in life is, if the journey of life comes to a standstill, do not get perturbed. That's your real test. If you quit, you are finished. If you stay, you will succeed eventually. She has been accorded with so many prestigious awards. OMG Book of World Records for hosting maximum numbers of world record events on YouTube channel Abba Jadhav. OMG Book of World Records for hosting 4 world record events in one show on YouTube channel Abba Jadhav. OMG Book of National Records for 100% attendance, for 3 years on the post of principal since April 2018 till the 26th of June 2021. Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam International Award of Excellence 2021 and many uncountable awards.
Hello friends, a master's in history and social education, certified internal auditor for school management, ISO standards, a qualified parenting coach, and an MBA in HR has not only enabled her to face life's challenges head on, but also take along with her her wards and those associated with her on the road to success, as she takes great pride in shaping their future, not only with knowledge, but also values to make them proud citizens. On behalf of the great mentors, me, Sushil Sinha, warmly welcomes Ms. Abba Jadhav, ma'am, for today's talk show session. Thanks, ma'am, for being with us and giving your valuable time.
Thank you so much, Sushil ji, and it's a pleasure to be here on this platform. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. First, we would like to know about your professional journey. Kindly share that.
Yes, professional journey was not that easy. It's like a complete 21 years, hard work and the efforts we have put in to reach here. So I have started my career in 2000 with the beginning of this century. And I have started with a small school known as Sun Grace Primary School in Surat.
Okay.
And that was the first year of not only my job, my career, but also as a teacher, I was very raw. So within first week, I went to my principal and I said, I can't teach. I can't teach these little children. Okay. So she gave a smile and said, ma'am, you have to at least work for a month so that we can appoint a new teacher. Till then, you have to accommodate with us. So I said, fine, I can't do it. So please have a new teacher soon. I can't do it. But, children are such people, such humans, in fact, I say, that they can change any thought process. And yes, after 1 month, I was not the person who went saying that that's not my work. And I was completely engrossed with children and I started loving children and I started teaching them. From there, I started my journey and then I worked with CS Vidya Bharati School again in Surat. Then from there, after working 4 years, I thought of working with a bigger institution, thinking that let's work at a bigger scale, let's teach in some good big school. Though all the schools which I worked through my career, they all were the best schools of the Surat. They are still the best schools of the Surat city. So after that, I worked for 7 years in SDGen Modern School, which is one of the best schools in Surat and all the cream students, all the rankers, all the toppers of CBSE boards and all, they come out of SDG and Modern School. So it gave me a lot of learnings. It gave me a lot of understanding of children, because 7 years is a long time. You spend with same children in one school. So yes, that was the time which actually sharpened my skills as a teacher. And that was the place, that was a term during where I completed my bachelor's of education, that is B.Ed. In social science and Hindi as main social science and Hindi as subjects. Then from there, again, there was a saturation point that, okay, now we are doing continuously same thing. So I was always eager and, hungry to learn new things, new system. And somewhere I was thinking that that digital things which I need to explore with children, I'm not actually getting those resources in this school, and let's explore for some better school than this in resources wise. Otherwise, that school has given me a lot. So after that, I went to GD Goenka International School, Surat, where I got blessed with some of very good mentors. They were also teachers over there, they were senior teachers. But yes, they guided me like anything. They sharpened me more as a teacher, more as an academician, more as an administrator. Matlab wahan pe, side mein, they have also, side by side, they kept on polishing those skills also, that how as a leader, I can shine. And that was the place where actually my work, my actions got noticed by the management and my work got appreciated. And I became, a very much popular teacher in the school very soon. After that, I got an opportunity to work with Tapti Valley International School. And then in between 1 year, I worked with some schools in Mumbai also. But just because of homesickness, and the distance and the local travel and all these, I could not adjust myself in Mumbai. So I came back in Surat and I started working as a PGT social science in Tapti Valley International School. There I met one of my best mentors of my life, Brigadier Sushil Bhasin, under whom we took almost 20 session training, live training throughout the year. Where I learned to set goals, and I set some of the goals for myself for March 2018. And you won't believe that I actually achieved my goal in 2018 March.
Great.
So on 1st April 2018, I was sitting on the chair of principal at Apex International School, Surat. So from there, my faith in Brigadier Sushil Bhasin got very much, strong. And then I started following his instructions, and I learned so many things from him, which actually helped me in developing my leadership quality at Apex International School, which was a kind of fresher's job on the post of principal for me, which was really challenging. But by God's grace and Sir's guidance, I was able to sail my boat smoothly for those 3 years. So very soon, my school, Apex International School over there, it became talk of the town, and it became very famous. And children, they used to love to be at school. Again, after 3 years, pandemic struck, and that was a kind of horrible time period we all educators faced. So after struggling for almost 1.5 year in this lockdown period, again, I thought of going to work on a better level. And I thought of contributing my services to a better institution. So I started hunting for some good opportunities. Luckily, I got an opportunity to work with Rahul International School, Vadgaon Sheri Branch, Pune. Again, I got an opportunity to work here as a founder principal. So we are into founder year over here. and it's really a great joy and fun to work over here. And I'm really enjoying my work. And again, I'm not boasting myself, but yes, here also in 6 months, we have made our school, you know, a point of topic, a point of talk among everyone. And that's my career.
It's really a great journey, ma'am. Students converted you in taking interest in teaching. They converted you in teacher form. And you kept upskilling yourself, not only in terms of teaching, rather in along with that in administration, in and even above that in technology part. It's really a great job.
Actually, I developed these technical skills, if I say that, you know, during this lockdown period, this 1 year of lockdown gave me a big opportunity to, you know, upskill my other sides, other talents. So I become founder of AJ School of Digital Learning. I became an author. I became a YouTuber, where my most famous talk show, Spotlight with Abba, is actually appreciated and admired by a lot of people. So, you know, all these kind of titles, they got added to my, you know, cap as a feather. So definitely I always took challenges as, you know, opportunity to grow further.
It's your hunger for upskill yourself. Because generally, people from non-science background, they generally are not much aware about digital and technology. But you entered in that segment, you upskilled yourself, you mastered yourself, and not only for yourself, what I have observed that you are also doing for others. You are training others. So it's really a great job what you've done. Really, ma'am. You also focus on work-life balance, right? Can you elaborate on that part?
Yes, this work-life balance is a very important factor, especially for all the teachers and educators right there. Because we always struggle between house and work. Why only teachers, if I say, everyone in this world, they are struggling to balance their work and life. Yes? So even housewife, I say, people say that housewives they're at home. Why they have to, you know, balance that work and life? Of course, they also have their own personal life too.
Correct.
So for them also, this work-life balance factor matters a lot. So whenever you ask any people for some work, they will simply give an excuse. Oh, what shall I do? I don't have time at all. But can we imagine this thing that everyone gets 24 hours? Everyone has 24 hours. But still, some people, if we take example of our very honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi, even he also have 24 hours in a day. But still, such people, they are able to do lot many work, lot many tasks in those 24 hours. And some people, when we see them, actually they are not doing anything. They are busy without work. And still, they always say, I don't have time. So very basic thing is behind, you know, the statement is not having time actually. The first factor that work is the laziness. We have never, you know, dropped those jacket of laziness and tried to analyze our schedule, our, you know, work pattern. So once we drop out that laziness from our personality, and if we sit with a pen and paper and note down, you're busy, okay. Note down what work you do whole day. And you will see that actually you have not done anything much and you still have so much of time to do lot many other things. And those gaps will give you the scope of doing new things. So for that, the first thing is that you have to identify what is important in your life? What are priorities in your life? You have to set priorities. But what happens is, a person takes responsibility of each and everything that comes on its way. Okay, मतलब सारी दुनिया का बोझ मेरे सिर पर ही है और मुझे ही सारा काम करना है. Why? Certain activities in our life, in our daily routine, are such which can be delegated to some other people, which can be done by some other people. It's not always that everything we only have to do with our own hands. We can send someone else to buy vegetables from the market. We can send someone else to pay the bills. It's not always that we only have to run everywhere. So first thing is, we have to set our priorities. What is urgent and what is important? Do that thing first, which is important but not urgent and can be done by someone else. Give that work to that some other person.
Right.
Which is urgent but not important, that also, and cannot be done by someone else, can be done by someone else. You can delegate that to someone else. So that way you will be able to find time slots in your schedule and you will be able to do two new things extra. So first thing is, you have to set priorities. Second is, you have to make a to-do list every morning. Whether it is a housewife's work or it's like a salaried person's work or a teacher's work or an educator's work, whoever the person is, first you have to make a to-do list every morning. So whenever you are sitting with your first cup of tea, give a 5 to 10 minutes of time to yourself. Keep a diary and pen nearby your table where you sit for your tea every morning. Just pick that diary. Think of the whole day, what things you are going to do today. Even the housewives, they have to write everything. That, okay, they have to cook breakfast, they have to, drop child to school, or after that they have to clean the house, or they have to bring clothes from laundry or something like that, whatever it is. Every little thing you do throughout the day, make entry of that thing in your to-do list. Then glance to all the activities you have noted down. Struck out those things which can be done by someone else. Only focus on the work, on the task that needs you. Like teaching, you're going on job, that needs you only. No one else can do. So you have to go there. But when you are going to school and you have to do certain work, there also you have to decide what work can be done by you and what can be delegated to students in a way that it can be done by the student and your job is also getting done. Sometimes you give responsibility to children. Your work, half work is done by children. It's not always that everything you only have to do. I have heard a lot of time complaint from teachers that, ma'am, during exam times, means just prior to exams, every school has a system of, doing revision worksheets. Bahut sara revision karwana padta hai. And teachers, they are literally struggling to correct those worksheets, to check those worksheets. So many a time it happens, most of the time it happens, that those worksheets are never corrected. So I give a simple example how you can get it done. Very easy. First of all, you make your worksheet objective. Though it should have objective questions. And then you tell your children to exchange their notebooks in the class. You just write down correct answers on the board. Ask children to do the correction. Mind well, they are going to do better correction than you. And you just have a look then, okay, whether they have corrected, okay, fine. They will never ever make mistake. You may be, in hurry, if you are checking, you may make a mistake as a teacher, but children will never make a mistake while correcting. They will check every minute thing what their friend has written because they are in competition. Right. So that way, every day your worksheet is checked. And for that, again, you have to plan your lecture in that way. that you are able to give that time of correction to the children. So make your worksheet of such time that, okay, your children finishes by, you know, 10 minutes prior to the lecture gets over. And in the later 10 minutes, you write the, by that time, you write down answers on the board in 5 minutes. And by that time, children will also exchange their notebooks. And it becomes easy for, you know, teacher to get all the notebooks corrected. And she only has to sign the notebooks then. So this is how you can, you know, delegate your work. You can, you know, share your responsibility to many. And you will get some time for yourself. So this is like second is to-do list. You have to uncheck the task which can be done by others. Third is analysis of that to-do list in the night. So before sleeping, again, you sit with that to-do list. Tick the task you have planned for the day and you were able to finish those tasks. So if you have done those tasks, give yourself a pat that yes, you have done it. Still, if you have been, you know, you are unable to do something, some task may be possible ki aapka list itna lamba ban gaya hai that you are not able to finish it off in the day. So you can shift those things to the next day. Gradually, you will see that those, undone things will get shortened. That list will get shortened. And you will be able to do all your tasks you have planned in a day, in that day only. And slowly, slowly, it will become your habit. And gradually, you will be able to manage your time well. So here again, your time management also gets, you know, on track along with these to-do list and the setting priority things. So time is not about like, you know, ki kisi ke paas hai, kisi ke paas nahi hai. Time is, you know, there for everyone. Equal time is how we manage it. Time doesn't manage us. No, we manage the time. So we have to see how beautifully we are planning those things. We have initially, definitely it will be tough. It's, always tough to develop a habit. But it's not that tough also. Once you start doing it, you will enjoy it when you start getting time for yourself. So definitely first is like, we have, as I said, set priorities, then you make a to-do list. And then again, make yourself time bound. In the sense, follow timelines strictly. Make a timetable of your whole day. And then find out where you are having those gaps to do extra work. Right. And give, yes, give that time to your own self, and that will be your me time. And this is how you will, this will be the beginning of work-life balance. And once you start with this, then the detailing can be done later on. Yes.
Really, time management is a skill. It's not required much of the hefty work. It can be done in a simple way, but most of the time people, they deliberately get away from that and they blame there is a lack of time. It's very true.
Yes.
Yes. Ma'am, you very much focus to this digital literacy. How this digital literacy will help students in upgrading themselves in terms of knowledge, in terms of upskilling themselves, in terms of their education and all?
Yes, this is now very important question in today's scenario where everything has gone digital. Now, when we talk of digital, most of the people, they simply connected to child sitting in front of laptop or having phone in his hand and watching YouTube videos or playing games. That is what they understand with digitalization. But actually, digitalization has a deep meaning, vast meaning with this. So when we talk of digital literacy, it has to do with how well you are, well-versed you are with the use of using internet. Are you able to use emails or, you know, you are able to do emails properly? Are you able to write Word files, create Word files and Excel sheets and all those things? So everything comes into digital literacy. It is not only with you know watching videos or what doing anything on internet. It has also to do with the social media things, because social media is completely online thing,
right.
Digital thing. It is related to your laptops and mobiles. So again, social media also comes into the part of digital literacy. So how your child, how a student is using those social media platforms, how much control parents have on their children, how much they are observant that how their children are using social media. Nowadays, you cannot stop any child to be on social media. Aap kisi bachche ko rok nahi sakte hain.
Not possible.
Yes, because it's completely a kind of revolution has come with the lockdown period, that everything has gone digital, everything has come online. So now you cannot stop children saying that kya mobile mat lo. Before lockdown, when things were not online, education was not online, we used to say, used to tell parents, don't give them mobile. Don't make them sit in front of laptop. Don't make them sit, watch TV and movies and all that. But what happened after lockdown? We educators only, told parents, bhai, aapko smartphone kharidna padega. You have to have laptop in house so that your child, can attend your online classes in a proper way. We are giving projects, based on internet. We are giving projects based on websites. So things are changing now. So we have to accept the change, and then we have to set our limits. That up to what limit, how much we have to tell our students. And at the same time, we have to keep a check. We have to give that way also to parents, that how you will keep a check on the use of social media or the digital platforms or the digital gadgets a child is using. In the classroom, if I talk, definitely when children are there, in many schools, laptops and iPads are given. Okay, tabs are given to children. So again, there, most of the time, I think I have seen that in one of the school where I worked, there was a system, centralized system, where if a child is playing games on iPad, or he's trying to access some unwanted site, which he should not open, the school system used to get immediate notification for that. They used to come in class and they immediately used to confiscate the iPad of that child.
Okay.
And they could tell what that child was watching or what that child was trying to open. I know such kind of system is not possible at every home, but we can keep a check by putting some child lock or making child understand what he should watch and what not. See, today's child is very much inquisitive, very much curious.
Right.
Agar hum unhe ye kahenge, beta ye mat karo, wo zarur karega.
They would definitely do.
Yes. So what we have to do? Okay, beta, you are not supposed to do this. But why he is not supposed to do this? That also to be told. So once the why is clear, we should let the child know what are the harmful effects of being on some social networks and on some social medias. There is a mannerism, there is a behavior pattern to be followed to be on some social media platforms. Once the child understands, he will always keep in mind the pros and cons of being on digital platforms, and definitely then only we can say that child is digital literate. And we have to channelize that digital literacy of the child into positive way. That how child can learn best out of those digital sources.
Thank you, ma'am, for elaborating in such a beautiful way. And that is very important, because nowadays it is inevitable to keep children away from all these digital devices and digitalization. But it is very much, at the same time, it is very much important they have to be constrained. Otherwise, they will start exploiting the thing, and they do it very frequently. Ma'am, how does digitalization improve classroom management? What do you think about this?
Yes, I think digitalization is a blessing for teachers because it has a lot of scope. You name it and you have it over there on internet. Yes, so definitely whichever teaching methodologies you are using, gone those days when you used to give lectures in the class and children used to listen very quietly. Today's child is not like that. The child will openly, you know, show the signals of sleeping if you are not involving him in the class. They will complain to the management that this teacher is boring, we don't like her. They have that much guts. Today's children, they have that guts. They will immediately go to their senior authorities saying that ye ma'am to kuch bhi interesting nahi padha rahi hai, hame inki class mein maza nahi aata, we don't want this teacher. We don't understand anything. They love the teacher who brings excitement in the class with innovative teaching methods. So how that innovation will come? Initially, we used to make a lot of teaching aids. Yes? We used to make charts and we used to make models and working models and all those things to demonstrate the things in the class. And this effort has been lessened by the, you know, digital platform. Now, most of the schools, they have smart boards in the class and they have beautiful features.
Yeah, right.
If teachers are trained properly how to use those boards effectively, they can work wonders, I'm telling you. Because I've seen this in my school. Our teachers have attended some workshop. They have been given training on some digital classroom methods. And now even I, you know, get wondered, ki, are, ye cheez humare time pe kyon nahi thi? Why could I could not, you know, enjoy these kind of things when I was teacher? No doubt right now also I'm teaching some classes. But yes, there are certain restrictions ki, you know, our subject also get restricted. So sometimes we have to work according to our subjects. Sometimes you have to work according to the need of child. So not sometimes, but most of the time, child is under the focus. So I would say by using smart boards, all the digital platforms, you know, involve children into this. Because they know better than you. If I have to work on Instagram, I'm still not that much literate to, you know, use Instagram effectively. But if you ask a child of 7th, 8th grade, he will make you understand how to use Instagram effectively. They will teach you that, okay, ma'am, you can put video like this. You can put photos like this. You can use link like this, reels and all that on and whatnot. You name it and they know better than you. Because they are so inquisitive, they are so curious that even if you are there or not, they keep learning many things on digital platforms. It's not always a child is playing games and, you know, watching videos on YouTube. Watching videos on YouTube means it's not always watching movies. There are a lot many good videos which give you thorough knowledge of, you know, various things happening in the world. And if teacher is not doing that, if teacher is not updating herself or himself with the time, soon they will be thrown out of the school by the children, not by the management. Because students will say, we don't enjoy the class of this lady or this sir. So school have to change them, the teacher. So it's high time for teachers to get digitally trained on these digital resources. Because our new educational policy is completely focusing on experiential learning, where learning is going to happen by doing. So if teachers are not training themselves on activities, on, you know, creativity, on using critical and creative thinking skills in the class, children will not enjoy the class.
Right, ma'am. In fact, 10 years back, the same type of things were initiated by some of the big companies like Tata Edge, HCL. EduCom was very much involved in that. EduWrite was involved in that. But on that time, people were not so literate about this digitalization. So on that time, it was not in so popular mode. But this pandemic given a bigger chance, bigger opportunity to each and every educationalist and whoever involved in this technology to upgrade, to upscale. And of course, students, they are much required of for all these things because the way time is changing, the coming time is, it's very practically how it's very much unthinkable how this is going to be changed. I don't think in coming time, even in a whiteboard, you just speak and the things will be in the written form there. Yes. even it's very much possible that in coming time, there is no need of chalk and duster and all.
Yes, it is said that soon there will be a time when there will be no teachers in the classes. No classes will be taken by robots. So like teachers have to work hard, otherwise robots are there to replace them soon.
Right. And it's not... only the thing of digitalization. Even the human being, they are going to face bigger challenges because in coming time, there is no need of a human being to work. The machines are replacing human work very rapid. But what they cannot change, they cannot produce emotion. They cannot have the emotional thinking. So human behavior, that should be changed in this modern time and in coming time.
Absolutely, I agree with this because human behavior is the thing which cannot be replaced by any machine.
Yes.
Now, though we talk about a lot of development in technology, but still some feelings, some emotions which we share with another human or children as a teacher, that cannot be created anywhere.
Yeah, right.
Okay, so yes, of course, along with all those digital things and the machines can replace the classroom system, but still we are going to teach humans. And to have that strong bonding with them, we need humans.
Yes.
Machine cannot create that bonding, which we have already experienced during this lockdown time.
Yes.
Through laptop, we are teaching online. So still that bond is missing.
Bond is missing. And think over it. When you teach in physical form, when you start writing on the board, the way a student think and the way they focus with you, they do not focus on in this digital platform and all. So their side, a human connection is required. Human emotion is required. Psychological connection is required. That cannot be replaced through this digitalization, right? So this is segment where physical involvement is always required. Whatever we use, companies use technology or digitalization, what I have observed, the thinking of a student, the thinking level of a student, that has been degraded in this digital education. Students are not focusing. They are not getting to be promoted to think over. They are just keeping okay. Sab kuch chal raha hai. They are just writing and they are going in such a way. But when they used to sit in the classroom, when teacher is in front of them, their thought process is provoking. That is missing here.
Absolutely. Yes. So we are waiting for schools to reopen very soon. Mm-hmm. And actually, we are thriving na ki kab ye sab shuru hoga so that we can bring that charm back to the class.
Yes.
Even now, students have also got bored at home. They are also eagerly waiting that, ma'am, when can we come to school and have that feel of school?
Yes. They are not only losing academic part, even physical, mental, in so many part they are losing.
Children have become lethargic. Now, yes. If we say them to play, they are not playing. Why? Because they have got into habit of sitting for longer times in front of screen.
Yes, screen, right. And they are yes. They are very much getting habituated with that. When they always try to be in front of this screen, whether in front of mobile or in front of television or in front of laptop, they always try to be in front of a screen. So it's a bigger loss what they are losing.
And I'm saying that once the schools are reopening, it is going to be a big challenge for teachers as well when they will be facing children in the school after pandemic, after this almost 2 years of gap when children have not entered into school, because they are not into habit of sitting for long hours. They're not into habit of sitting at one place. They're not in habit of, you know, having breaks at certain times. Ghar pe hain, so, you know, they can munch at any time. They can go washroom anytime. But when they will come into school back, so they have to, you know, come into a system. So again, teachers have to work hard to create that discipline, to create that system, bring them to a systematic pattern of being in school.
Right.
So that matters a lot. This is a point of really, to think on that, how we are going to manage these things.
Right.
We are thinking that, okay, we are dying to teach them. But at the same time, we have to be prepared for the other challenges that are going to come with the children when they're coming back to school. So we have to be on our toes. Yes.
Right. Academic challenges, to baat ki baat hai. Pehle non-academic challenges, they're unko face
karna. Absolutely.
That's going to be even a bigger challenge. And of course, schools are facing. Wherever schools has started, they are facing this issue. They are not getting the same children what they have left 2 years back.
True.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for giving your valuable time, being with us, giving you so much insights in education, digitalization. Thank you so much. Thank a lot, ma'am.
Thank you, Sushilji, for inviting me over here and giving me an opportunity to share my views on this platform. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.